Preston rancher Jay Wilde had a dream to restore beavers to Birch Creek. His goal was to make Birch Creek a perennial stream and provide water for his cattle and horses. But each time he released beavers on his own nickle, they vanished.
But they didn't stay. They left, or they didn't survive, or the predators got them, we don't know. It got pretty obvious to me that I didn't know what I was doing as far as relocating beavers.
Then Jay met Joe Wheaton from Utah State University. A professor of watershed sciences, Wheaton specializes in using beavers and low-tech woody structures to restore streams.
They actually have a model that they put together that it's called BRET, Beaver Restoration Assessment Tool, and that'll identify good beaver habitat. It'll estimate how many dams will be supported by the habitat that's here. Finally, I knocked on the right door.
Wheaton came up to visit Jay right away to do a BRAT analysis of Birch Creek with colleague Nick Bouwes.
The core of it is this, what we call a capacity model. It just looks at the vegetation that's present and asks the question about, you know, its suitability as a dam building material. And then it looks at the hydrology.
The BRAT analysis predicted that beavers might build 25 to 60 dams per mile.
Largely, that's because there's a ton of great aspen, cottonwood, other species that they like to use.
Turns out the beavers loved Birch Creek Canyon. Following the release of 9 beavers in the first 2 years of the project, there are over 175 beaver dams in Birch Creek 5 years later. This is a story where dreams can come true. Jay Wilde showed a great deal of grit and tenacity in bringing beavers back to Birch Creek. A big silver lining is that his granddaughter Emily participated in the whole project from the beginning, dating back to her high school years.
We used to come up here every summer when I was a kid, a couple of times. And the first thing my sister and I would do is put our bags down in the house and then run out and go play in the creek for like hours on end, you know, finding all the bugs and all the plants that we could. By the time I was about 14, I started to understand that this is what I wanted to do. This is what I want to spend my life doing, just playing in the creek.
So what could be better than restoring a creek with beaver?
I thought it might be a really cool opportunity to learn something new and to kind of expand my knowledge and figure out exactly what I wanted to do when I grew up.
Emily is a junior at Utah State University now, majoring in natural resources.
I thought it was really cool to kind of restore the landscape, not necessarily fix it, but restore it to what it once was.
Yes, but how did they do it? How could they ensure that the beavers would stay? Let's take a moment to learn more about the science-based strategy and why the beavers are doing so well in the Birch Creek watershed. The BRAT analysis seemed promising. Jay also remembered that there were beaver dams in Birch Creek when he was a kid. Jay invited key Forest Service people to meet with Wheaton to understand the potential. Wheaton suggested that they build several beaver dam analogs in Birch Creek to test out the concept. But first, they would need permits from the Forest Service, as the BDAs would be located on Caribou Targhee National Forest land, and stream alteration permits from the Idaho Department of Water Resources and the Army Corps of Engineers. Brett Roper, a Forest Service watershed scientist who also teaches at Utah State, helped with the Forest Service permitting process.
Brett basically got involved and said, look, I've been doing research and work with these guys for years. I can vouch for this. And moreover, I'm willing to put my neck out there and I'll sign off on a categorical exemption under NEPA for this.
And Brad Higginson, a Caribou Targhee hydrologist, helped push the IDWR and core permits through in record time. They built 4 BDAs that fall, using a $3,000 grant from the Forest Service for building materials. Jay and Emily pitched in along with Casey Wilde, Emily's dad, and Jay's son. In 2016, they built 15 more BDAs on Birch Creek while holding a stream restoration educational workshop on site.
So structures were built to provide a comfortable release site for beaver so they weren't freaked out. but we expected them to be like teenagers and not listen. So wherever you dump them, have some choices downstream and some choices upstream. And then, you know, maybe on their way out or up, they'll use one of those. And indeed they did.
The deep water habitat created a safe place for the beavers to hide from predators and set up shop. They released 6 beaver that fall.
Beavers are definitely hardwired in these areas of the cold winter. Give them enough time that they can build those dams and build a food cache, etc. But, you know, you dump a whole family there, they may look around and say, yeah, okay, actually this will work, and let's make a go of it.
Idaho Fish and Game live trapped a family of nuisance beavers from nearby and assisted with the release in Birch Creek. The beavers went right to work, creating a large beaver pond above Jay's ranch.
So this is our biggest dam right now. It's a lodge. This is a primary dam that they built in 2017. And so beyond this, they have about 10 more secondary dams. But this big one holds most of the water from here down. Like, it holds an amazing amount of water. We've also seen a lot of response from fish. Like, the fish have gotten really big and really healthy recently too because of this dam.
The following year, the beavers built more dams, had more offspring, and the beaver dams continued to multiply in Birch Creek.
It's been so fun to watch all the changes. So many things have happened, positive things have happened, that I didn't even dream of.
Forest Service officials are excited too.
And so these beaver dams, they do a lot for the stream flow, they do a great deal for fish habitat. As you can see, Birch Creek before was maybe 2 feet wide and a couple inches deep. And now you can see how deep it is and the amount of fish that would be in these ponds. Another thing these beaver dams do is they elevate the water table. And so you see a lot of storage in the channel, but what you don't see is all the water storage that is underneath the land. Now, you have all that storage that gets stored during the spring runoff when there's excess water available. And then in the late summer, early fall, that water continues to feed the stream, which helps the stream flow all year long.
So far, Birch Creek is flowing 40 plus days longer than it did pre-beaver. Wet meadow habitat around the beaver dams diversifies the habitat for insects and birds around the stream. Fish life has rebounded in a big way too.
So they're Bonneville cutthroat trout. They are actually a pure strain. And so it was really important to kind of make sure that they're doing well. We did a fish count with the Forest Service, and so we electrofished, which I thankfully got to be a part of. And we just kind of caught, I think it was like 130 was our final total, 132.
You'd get pretty excited to see something that big or, you know, that big, right? And I mean, it's just shallow, you know, sort of scrappy habitat they're scraping by. Now what, we've gone from a fish density of like 5 fish per 100, you know, meters up to somewhere around 70.
Like a 10 to 20 fold increase in fish out there. So fish need water, but they also need habitat. Beaver ponds, you know, they provide a lot of habitat complexity that the stream alone doesn't provide. They provide, you know, overwintering areas, holding water, deep water areas. They increase the productivity of the insects in there, which provides more food source for the fish. All the little edge water habitat, the little beaver channels that go out through everything really provide a lot of rearing nursery habitat for the young fish.
Jay's excellent land stewardship and grazing management also made the beaver project a success, officials said.
I can't underscore enough just how important the grazing management as a precursor was to this story. There's a lot of places that we go to work where, you know, you look at the riparian and you look at the resources that beaver, if you're gonna leverage them, you would need beaver to have to really thrive. And, you know, you've gotta fix the grazing management first. Here, that was done and it had been done, you know, so well, it just makes it really easy to look good.
Jay follows the Allen Savory system of grazing management, using intensive cattle grazing on small pastures for a short period of time, and then moving on to the next pasture. He shows us an example.
We grazed this early this spring in May, and we grazed it down really close. And this is the recovery we've got.
The vibrant grass growth on Jay's private land stands in contrast to a different property owner to the north and Forest Service land to the east.
We've been able to do this, make it look like this, without doing any seeding, without any chemical treatments, no mechanical treatments. It's all been done by the way we manage the grazing.
Jay uses temporary solar fence to create small pastures, and he rotates the cattle to new pastures frequently throughout the grazing season.
I don't like to stay longer than a week, because in a week's time, that grass that's ate off on day one is trying to grow. It's trying to recover, and we need to let that happen. It's not only intensive grazing, it's intensive labor and management. You've got the fences to put in. We had to put in a water system, and we piped that water to troughs in strategic spots.
Jay tapped a spring and dug an underground water line to a stock tank that serves four pastures on his private land. By paying close attention to grazing management, Jay not only has nurtured healthy rangelands and created wildlife habitat, he also is putting more pounds on his cows, an important factor at harvest time.
One of the selling points of that is if you do this intensive grazing, you can double your stocking rate. Yeah, if you got more cows out there with calves on, why, you're generating more beef, more revenue.
Jay closely monitors the range. This series of slides shows the riparian vegetation coming back in Birch Creek pre-beaver from 2001 to 2010. At last count, there are more than 165 beaver dams in the Birch Creek watershed.
It's been a dream come true for me.
Jay and Joe Wheaton have held numerous Show Me educational tours in the area. Beavers aren't perfect. They need to be managed, Wild points out, but they have a role to play as a keystone species.
Well, I grew up here hating beavers because they were always plugging our irrigation ditches and one thing or another, creating problems. That was the mentality back then. Well, we got to think about beavers as our friend instead of our foe. It's what we have to call a paradigm shift. There's a lot of people that changed their mind like I have. And we've decided that, you know, in order for these watersheds to be healthy, we need beavers.
Now, Wheaton takes Jay on the road for educational workshops about restoring streams. There's a big need for more stream restoration projects, and it's a powerful thing for landowners to lead the way.
I would love to replicate Jay's story, you know, thousands of times over. Just turned into a dear friend, and you know, he and I mean, we've done workshops in Montana and Wyoming and Colorado, Nevada, Idaho. Jay telling the story to his neighbors, to other ranchers, like this is what it means, you know, to him and to his operation, etc. It's been huge. It's inspired a lot of people.
I think there's a good chance that this will start growing really quickly. It's incredibly easy to implement. I think it can be pretty widespread if we want it to be.